Brahmananda Parama Sukhada Kevala Jnanamurti Dandva Gagana Sadrisham Tatvama Sayadhi Laksham Ekam Nitya Vimala Achala Sarvadi Sakshi Bhuta Bhavatita Triguna Rahita Sadguru Tam Nama
We begin with a prayer. Divine Mother, Heavenly Father, Friend, Beloved God, Babaji Krishna, Jesus Christ, Lahiri Mahashaya, Swami Sri Yukteswar, my beloved Gurudev Paramhansa Yogananda, beloved friend and guide Swami Kriyananda, saints and sages of all religions, I humbly bow to you all. Thank you for blessing this Gita class. Thank you for raising all our vibrations. Thank you for connecting us to Source. Om Shanti Shanti. So we'll take off from where we left off last time. I don't know how many new people are there. Sonali, do you know?
A couple of them, and I think more will be joining in a due course of time.
Then I am not kind of repeating the basic. Story is just the conversation between Krishna and Arjuna on the eve of the battle of Kurukshetra. And Arjuna represents every man. Arjuna is us, basically, the devotee or the human being on the path of evolution. And he is asking Krishna all manner of questions. What is the purpose of life? why are we here, what is right action, what is wrong action, what is the meaning of karma, what is dharmic action, what does self-realization mean? Okay, so we will start from where we left off. And Casey, come. Let me introduce you to somebody very important. This is Casey Kalicharan. He is 2 months old and he is here to bless the class. He meditates every day with me. Now he's saying, okay, bye, Casey.
He's too cute.
Very cute. And what inspired you to write the name, you know, to call him Casey?
Kalicharan. He's a black cat. He's a devotee of the goddess Kali. So he's very fierce. Okay. Right. So we start, we were at page 192, I think, last time. And it was verse 422 that I have to start with, right?
Yes.
I didn't really mark it, but I think that is it. Yeah. So this verse says, he is free from karmic involvement, who is contented with whatever comes to him uninvited, who is even-minded and untouched by duality, who is without envy, jealousy, and animosity, and who finally views success and failure with equanimity. So Arjuna had asked Krishna, you know, what is the meaning of karma? What is karmic action? How can I be free of karmic action? And so Krishna is answering that a person who is absolutely okay with whatever happens, good, bad, indifferent, that person is free from karmic involvement, because that person has actually realized the true nature of this world, that this is the world of Maya or duality. And this is just a game that we are playing in order to learn and grow from the various experiences of good and bad, black and white. All of us are part of God or Source. And in order to experience who we really are, we need to experience who we are not. And therefore, the world of relativity or Maya was born. And in this, a person who has gained enough wisdom to be able to understand the nature of duality and to rise above it and look at the big picture, cannot really take all that is happening here very seriously. They play the game all right to the hilt, but without any attachment to the result, because they know that karma is just a learning mechanism. We are required to take action, because without action, there is no experience. So we have signed up before we have come onto this earth. We have actually signed up to play this game of duality, because through understanding darkness and contrasting it with light, we start to understand our true nature, which is neither darkness nor light. It is Nirguna Brahma. What is Nirguna Brahma? It means Brahman or Source has no qualities. It is a field of possibility. Everything is possible if we connect to source. But of itself, it does not have the three gunas or qualities of sattvic quality, rajasic quality, tamasic quality, like I was explaining last time. So a person who has really understood this, therefore does not get affected by the ups and downs of life and keeps a complete equanimity no matter what he or she is going through, that person is free from karmic involvement. That person is a person who is so connected to source that they have complete faith in source, that whatever is happening is just a lesson for me to learn who I am by experiencing who I am not. And therefore, any action which this person is performing is without attachment, because they know it is just drama, it is just a game. And if in this life, okay, I have been put in this position in the world, this is what I got to do, well, then I do it and I keep moving through. And even if I take a wrong action and the consequences are not so good, I'm not too worried, because I know that if I stay calm, if I look at the situation as from the point of view of what do I need to learn from it, then I will again get back on the dharmic path and I will move forward in my soul's journey. So then Swami Kriyananda says, though we have dealt with this subject before, it might be well to consider once again briefly its opposite case. One who allows himself to be upset by the unexpected, who is always jumping with joy or bowed down with disappointment, who is full of envy, jealousy, hatred, and one finally who rejoices gleefully in success and is emotionally devastated by failure. Are such people ever blessed with peace of mind? Okay, so the shloka or the verse talks about a person who is beyond all this. Now Swamiji is posing the question from the other side. So what happens to a person who's constantly at the mercy of this world of duality, and at one moment he's exhilarated, next moment he's depressed, and there is no peace of mind, okay? Are such people ever blessed with peace of mind? For one who has no inner peace, as Krishna stated earlier, how is happiness possible? What passes in worldly minds for happiness is usually nothing but emotional excitement, or sometimes a temporary release from some cause for agitation or suffering. Excitement leads to fear, doubt, and uncertainty. Temporary release from excitement leads not to contentment, but to eventual boredom and apathy. So, somebody who is constantly going up and down and getting caught up in the drama of life does not really connect to himself. The joy that he feels is not real lasting joy. It is just a temporary excitement at getting something. And when we go to the high, we can easily dip to even lower depths of depression, right? So a true yogi does not do this. They are always calm and they do not get affected by things of this world. Many people might say, but does that make me unfeeling? Does that make me an automaton? The point is, if we are able to remain calm, while this up and down is happening, it is only then that we can access source. And source energy is certainly not boring. It is the most powerful, most joyful, most magnetic feeling that you can ever have. And so we do not become automatons when we follow the Gita and remain calm. We are able to plumb depths of which we have no idea. There are worlds upon worlds. What is Satchidananda? Sat Chit Ananda. Truth, consciousness, bliss. So the quality of the universe is everlasting bliss. It is an incredible high. If in meditation, at some point, it will happen, those who meditate here, you will touch that bliss, if even for a second, or maybe for 10 minutes, or maybe for a week, when you touch that, you will know why the masters are always saying, you know, calm down, understand this world is false, but do your part, raise your vibration. And once you go beyond this constant up and down drama, only then will you be able to access source, which is indescribable. It cannot be told to anybody. You need to experience it for yourself. And Kriya Yoga is one way of experiencing this bliss for oneself. So yoga will always tell you that your self-effort, nobody is going to hand it to you on a platter. You have to put in the energy and offer yourself to source in meditation. And when you are able to do that, then you can draw down the grace. Right? So excitement leads to fear, doubt, uncertainty. Why? Because you feel, oh my God, I may lose this, or this might not happen. All manner of conditions you place on the world. Okay? And temporary release from excitement leads not to contentment, but to eventual boredom and apathy. So these are all surface, excitement, boredom, apathy. These are surface feelings. What we are aiming at is to open the heart center where the real feelings are. Real feelings, what is real, you will know something that does not change. Okay, what happens now? Suppose we love somebody, the moment that somebody does not live up to our expectations, we begin to hate that somebody. So this wasn't really true love in any case, right? So we have to go beyond that. True love does not change regardless of what the other person is doing or saying or behaving. We are trying to move towards that kind of devotion and love. And as I keep saying that, no matter how perfectly you practice the techniques, no matter how many hours you spend in meditation, if your feeling quality, if the heart center is not open with devotion and love for source, that is for ourselves only. Source quality is us. If that does not happen, your spiritual progress will be okay. You'll get success, you'll be focused, you'll be calm, all those things. But the actual transformation of the being is not going to happen. So the first thing to cultivate is the heart's true feelings. Okay. It is interesting to notice how automatically people reveal by their gestures the way the energy is flowing in their bodies. See when they are excited, how they jump up and down. It is because of the upward movement in the Ida Nadi in the spine. And see also how little children who are least inclined to control their outward displays of emotion may indicate a downward movement of energy in the spine through the Pingala Nadi by flinging their arms downwards, stooping, repeatedly stamping their feet, and exhaling repeatedly with loud cries, even rolling on the ground and pounding their fists. All such downward gestures indicating the downward direction of their energy. So I'll just explain this Ida Nadi and Pingala Nadi. It's a little confusing. I'll go to the board. Can be seen, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So remember, was I saying it in this class? No, in the other class. Okay, but all the tools of reaching enlightenment are there already in this body, in our energy body. What is that? It is the very, very complex nervous system and the brain. And beyond that is the energy body. Beyond our physical body is the energy body and the causal body, which is the thought body. Okay. So in the energy body, there are the three main energy channels are, say this is a person. Right? This is the astral spine, okay? Now, in the astral spine is a very, very important central meridian, energy meridian, which is known as the Sushumna. This is the channel through which the Kundalini will rise when you are nearing enlightenment. Okay. There are two other main energy channels. One is the Ida, I-D-A, if you look at your book. This is the channel which is governed by the energy of the moon. It is the feminine channel. And it spirals around the Sushumna Nadi up like that and connects us to the right hemisphere of the brain. Which is the right hemisphere? It is the intuitive brain, the seat of intuition, creativity, whatever. This is the Ida Nadi, and the energy movement here is upwards, okay? Which takes us inwards, which is the feminine receptive quality. All of us have masculine and feminine in us, okay? Now the Pingala Nadi comes from here and it will start spiraling up. Sorry, I should have drawn it from below. This one's movement is outward into the world. This is the Pingala Nadi, okay? And this one, the downward movement, is the masculine energy which has to deal with the world. Left brain, logic, practicality, whatever. All those, just the opposite of intuition and imagination. This is the sun, governed by the sun. This is the moon. So what is happening?
Hello?
Ah,
pain.
It's all okay.
When we start first Hello? Meditating.
Hello?
No, no, I. No, no, Sunday.
He has to be muted.
I'm on mute.
Sorry.
On mute.
So, now, that is why when we first start meditating, many of us feel a circular movement. That is because we are gathering the energies in the main task of meditation, shall we say, is to get all our energies flowing up the central channel, the Sushumna Nadi. So it will start when we do the meditative practices, it starts pulling in all the energy from outward into the Ida and Pingala and finally into the Sushumna. So here Swami Kriyananda is saying that when people, you know, just the body posture will tell you whether your energy is rising upwards or going down. So when we are feeling very energetic, when we are feeling very happy, what do? We take in a deep breath. We are happy. When we are not feeling so good, what do? We sigh. And the whole body is slumped. So just by seeing a person, the way they sit, the way they walk, you know, you can make out whether this is a positive person or this is a person with a tendency towards negativity, right? So what is a yogi trying to do? Neither positive nor negative, but neutral, neutral, neutral. And that is source energy to access Nirguna Brahma, which is what we are all trying to do, because source has no quality. Source is just a field of quantum possibilities or everything. Everything is there in source.
Can we ask a question, please?
Yes, please.
Can you just repeat that Pingla thing? Ida starts from down and goes towards the right hemisphere. Pingla starts from left hemisphere?
Yes, it will feed the left hemisphere.
Okay.
And the energy will move down.
Okay.
The energy in that channel will move downwards and outwards into the five senses. Our five senses are what connects us to the world. The senses of touch, hearing, taste, all those things are given to us so that we are drawn outward into the world and we get entangled in the world. When we get entangled, only then is when we have these experiences. And through those experiences, we rise above them. We learn through the consequences of our own actions and we move forward. So when people come on the spiritual path, basically, they have had lifetimes of the drama and they have had enough. They are now making a conscious decision of moving back to source. And so they start to withdraw their senses. I mean, you may be active in the world, but it doesn't affect you so much anymore. You fail to be taken in by the drama. You have a big picture where you can spot a pattern a mile away and you know exactly why this has come up and what you have to learn from it. So pattern recognition is a very, very important lesson of the spiritual eye. When we open the spiritual eye, then we can see the patterns clearly. Why did I do that? Why did this happen? Oh my God, yeah, I realized that it's coming from my childhood. This is what I was told. This is how I have behaved all the time. It has become a habit and that habit has not served me. I have made at least 5 mistakes reacting to a certain kind of situation in the same way, repeatedly. So when my third eye starts to open, I realize that, okay, so what I believed was not really right. If I want different results, I cannot be acting the same way. I have to change. Right? So that is what this understanding does to us.
Okay. Only one more question. Yeah. So you said that these are governed by the two nadis, are governed by moon and sun. So do they have prominence in terms of the planetary position of this, like when you said the govern, like how govern?
Yeah. Planetary. So you will see that many people get really affected by the cycles of the moon. They'll go moody, they'll go this and that. So the quality of the Ida Nadi is inward. It is school. It has a different kind of power. The quality of the Pingala Nadi, governed by the sun, is more active. It's outward. It's more aggressive. And this is more receptive. Contentment itself is a virtue and not merely a consequence. It should be practiced consciously. One should tell himself, I need nothing, I need no one. In myself, I am free. So this is a useful affirmation to have. The key word over here is need. What does need imply? It implies a sense of lack. But we have to understand that actually we have everything. We don't need anything or anyone. We are on the spiritual path. We are trying to be complete beings who, if they are in relationship with somebody, it is because of the joy of the relationship. Not because I need something from you. Any relationship based on need is going to be energy draining. Both of you, if people are coming at each other with unfulfilled needs and expecting the other to fulfill it, first of all, the other can never do it. And then you will constantly be expecting and draining the other person of energy. So what one has to become is a complete being who has no need, but because there is love overflowing here, out of joy that person gives. And there is no expectation, but the universe is also weird. It works in contradiction. The moment there are no expectations, you will see you will get 110% return from the other side the day you stop needing it. So that is the power of letting go. Very difficult. But this is the lesson. If you can become complete in yourself and you don't need anything or anybody and you're happy, the joy wells up from inside. It is an inner joy. It is a causeless joy. It is just the joy of being connected to source. So contentment is one of the niyams, Patanjali's disciplines. So if we can practice contentment, be absolutely okay with what is. When we succeed in that, then we can plumb the depths. We can go beyond the surface drama. Stop complaining. Be perfectly okay with what is. Keep doing what I'm supposed to do. Inside, I am whole. I am complete. Nobody or nothing can shake me really. So that is something we need to strive for. Contentment does not mean complacency. Contentment means being okay with what is at this moment. So the next verse is, all the effects of karma or action are nullified in oneself and one achieves liberation when ego attachment ceases, when one becomes centered in wisdom, and when all one's actions are offered up in sacrifice to the infinite. So it is basically elaborating on the first verse that we read. So there are no karmic effects of action taken by a person who is enlightened like this. A liberated person, no matter what he or she does not attract karma. Because they act not from the ego. They are always connected to source And whatever action they are doing is actually being channeled from source. So they get out of the way, knowing that knowing that this physical body is anyway an illusion. We are all part of that one energy, which is source. So ego attachment. What is the ego? Now understand, Yogananda used to give the example that of a gas flame where the burner has many holes and little flames come out of the holes. But when you trace it back, you will see the origin is only one flame. It is only showing up as 10 flames because of the gas burner's structure, which has little holes. So Master used to say that we need to see beyond this and understand that we are all coming from source. And these little flames which have come up are actually us encased in a body with an ego. What is an ego? Ego means a sense of separateness from the self. And that separation brings anxiety in us. And therefore, we attach to things, not knowing that we are all things. We have everything. Okay? So attachment comes only because the ego feels separate from source and feels insecure, feels unsafe, so tries to cling to other people, tries to cling to wealth, tries to cling to many, many worldly things. But a yogi knows this, and the yogi keeps offering the entire being up to source, knowing that that is where it belongs. For such a person, both the act of self-offering and the offering itself are equally aspects of the one spirit. The fire of wisdom and the person making the offering are both spirit. In this realization, the yogi freed from ego identification goes straight to Brahman or spirit. So whether it is the doer, whether it is the action that is being done, whether it is me offering up something, whether it is the offering itself, all of it are parts of source. Any karma or action performed has consequences, no less so in the case of a liberated master than of the worldly person. The difference is that since the actions of a master are not performed with ego identification, the effects of that action are not bound to ego and flow out freely into the world, bringing only beneficial results. Their objective rewards are reaped by those who are in tune with them and accept them lovingly. So when an enlightened master comes in a human body, in a egoic form, in this world, their actions have no karmic repercussions because they are always conscious that they are part of source. What in fact is spirituality is to be conscious at every point that I am part of source. So the masters always say, I am not doing anything. God is doing through me. So they are clear channels of the divine. They have no ego. So Yogananda used to say that I killed Yogananda a long time ago. Nothing dwells here but God. So the ego is completely absent, complete clear channels of source. So those actions will never get the karmic repercussions. They will only benefit those they are meant to benefit. It is important for people when they perform any religious ritual to understand the hidden purpose of the ritual itself. If it is truly religious in nature, it serves the symbolic purpose of offering the ego up into a higher reality. Even a simple bow is a gesture of self-offering. The ego, which is physically centered in the medulla oblongata at the base of the brain, becomes relaxed at this point when one bows and is offered forward. At least such is the intention. Properly, that offering should be made to the spiritual eye in the forehead, the positive pole of the medulla. People generally, however, consider their bows as outward gestures to something or to someone before them. So let me explain this. So now Krishna has gone into explaining, because at that time, there in Dwapar Yuga, descending energy age, people were really getting into a lot of rituals, and they would only ask, and they use those rituals not to connect to source, but to ask source for things. So Krishna has gone into explaining these rituals and how they should be performed. Okay, it is important to understand the hidden purpose of the ritual itself. So the ritual is actually a symbolic offering. Whatever you're putting in that fire is a symbolic offering of the self up to source. But many people don't understand that. Okay, and certain things, like in the Indian culture, the namaste and the bow are actually, the namaste is acknowledging that you are equally source. I am equally source. I am in my space. I don't need to invade your space. That's why we don't shake hands. I am bowing to you. You are a complete individual. I am a complete individual, and I respect you for that. Similarly, when we bow down, like we will bow down and touch the feet of a guru, or we will bow down in devotion, why is it done? So, what is Swamiji saying? This is the medulla oblongata, okay, at the base of the brain. It is the seat of the primitive brain. It is the seat of the ego, seat of fear, okay? This is the seat of reason. You will see that only human beings have a forehead. Animals have a sloping forehead. They don't have the seat of reason. They are only operating from instinct. But we have the faculty of reason or intuition. And what do? In meditation, we are moving the fear energy from here up to the spiritual eye. The energy movement is like this when we meditate, okay? So we are kind of cleansing the ego energy, and we are moving up to the enlightened energy, to the third eye or the spiritual eye. And when we bow down, what is happening? Bowing down is very important because it brings the energy of the ego over here. It cultivates humility. that I bow down to somebody, I am humble enough to know that I am not doing everything. There is a much higher power. So that is why obeisance and bowing, it is actually scientifically the energy is being moved here so that we become less egoistic. Properly, that offering should be made to the spiritual eye in the forehead, is what I just explained. People generally, however, consider their bows as outward gestures to something or to someone before them, which it is not actually. It is you offering your ego up to source. Arati is a ceremony of waving light before an altar. So we light the lamp and we do this in front of the deity or the master. So that is arati. Is a symbolic offering of one's own light and energy up to God. So whatever light and energy we have, when we are doing arati, we are giving it to God. Puja or worship is performed by offering all the five senses, signifying ego consciousness, up to God's representation on the altar. So when we do puja, all the various things, so that we use in the puja, we'll use certain foods, we'll use flowers, we'll use certain offerings. Each of them actually represent the five senses in different ways. Okay. Yajna offers ghee or purified butter and rice into the sacrificial fire, again to symbolize various aspects of self-offering. So if we understand the rituals and the puja properly, we will see that all of it is an attempt to offer the ego up to source. It is an attempt to understand this small ego needs to be destroyed at some point, needs to be offered up for purification to the source. The Christian Eucharist too represents a commemoration of the Last Supper and the worshipper's gratitude for what Jesus Christ brought to mankind. This ceremony is traditionally followed by receiving bread and wine, symbolic of the blessings brought to mankind by Jesus. Hindu ritual is followed by the offering of prasad to indicate, again, symbolically, the receiving of God's grace. So always some fruits and sweets are offered before a puja, and after the puja, we believe that the fruits and the sweets have been consecrated, and so we offer that prasad to people so that they can partake of the high vibration. Arati, or that doing the light, arati too is ended by the light being taken around to everyone, that all may receive God's light symbolically into themselves. So when the light is passed around, what do? We put our hands in front on the flame and we do this. We take the blessing from the flame. The entire spiritual path consists of offering up the ego to God for purification and of receiving his grace or kripa in return. Only thus can one eventually attain oneness with him. So it is the puja, or all these rituals are actually a way of establishing a relationship with the divine. Whether we do it through meditation or we do it through the rituals, it is a way of connecting with the divine. The subsequent stanzas of the Bhagavad Gita all concern themselves with the various types of rituals that are performed by spiritual aspirants. So now Krishna is going into all this. Some yogis there are who make sacrifices to the devas or the deities. Others see sacrifice or yajna as an offering of the self into the cosmic fire of spirit. So some people make sacrifices to the devas. What are the devas? Devas are the gods and goddesses of the astral world. They have certain powers which, if you appeal to them, they can grant you certain wishes, but they are not source. Okay. In fact, the devas also want to be born on earth, because it is only in the realm of duality that spiritual growth is possible. The devas are beings who are trapped in the beautiful astral heavens, where it is so wonderful that the desire to progress is no longer there. So they may remain stuck there for God knows how many centuries or billions of years. But these devas have certain powers, and sometimes we appeal to these, shall we say, lesser gods when we want material things. When we want, oh, please, God, pass my child and in the exams. Please, God, give me some wealth. All those things. So, yeah. Most people find it difficult to love God as an abstraction. He is pure consciousness, but they find it easier to endow him with a form that represents whatever divine aspect or quality most attracts them. God is beyond all forms and is supremely impersonal. At the same time, God has also taken on every form in the universe. So what does Sanatan Dharma say, or this religion? We won't even call it Hinduism, it is the eternal religion. What does that say? That it does not say God created the universe. It always says God manifested the universe. What's the difference between creating and manifesting? When you say manifested the universe, it means that God is not separate from the creation. It's not some force from outside which has made something with which it has no connection. God is manifest in every little thing, good, bad, indifferent in the world. So God is manifest in us, in the Christ consciousness, Krishna consciousness, at the spiritual eye. And that is why in meditation, we constantly focus here to activate the Christ consciousness or the Krishna consciousness, okay? So God is beyond all forms and is supremely impersonal. At the same time, God has also taken on every form in the universe. He is impersonal in that he wants nothing for himself, but in each of us, he has become personal by encasing his consciousness in our forms. He loves us individually on our own level of understanding. So wherever you are on the evolutionary path, that is where you will connect to God. So your God can be a punishing God, depending on where you are. If you are in still a lot of fear-based energies, you will think, if I do wrong, God is going to punish me. If so, your God is a punishing God. If you move forward in evolutionary terms, your God will be a benevolent God. It's a God that always has your back, and you can do no wrong because you are a child of God. So it depends on where you are on the evolutionary journey, that your understanding of source or God will differ, and you will choose to worship whatever it is that is most that is resonating with you. So some people like to see God as Father, some people like to see God as Divine Mother, Some people like to see God as the friend. Some people like to see God as the lover. Whatever is your need, wherever God will appear to you, like that. He loves us individually on our own level of understanding. Thus, he suffers in and for those who suffer. Yet in himself, he is ever in bliss. So God has empathy for us, but he is not affected because he knows this is temporary. This is just a something we have to go through to finally merge in him. He rejoices in our earthly joys, yet in himself is not identified with them. The case is similar to a mother and her children. When they weep, she feels their pain. At the same time, however, she feels no pain in her own self. She may even whack them to discipline them, right? But she knows that this is a learning process and it's okay. She doesn't get destroyed by it. So I think we'll keep it till this much today. It's 5. Okay, so see you next Sunday. Any questions today?
For me, I have a question. When you say God is within us, is it present in the form of a spirit or higher self?
Consciousness. Sorry? He is present in the form of consciousness. So yes, spirit. Yes, higher self, if you like to say it that way. Yeah.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay, so we end today with a prayer. Divine Mother, Thou art omnipresent. Thou art in all Thy children. Manifest Thy healing power in all bodies, minds, and souls. Please rub your hands and we'll bring up the healing energy. Send that energy to the world to raise our vibrations. Please chant Om with me 3 times as we send out the healing energy. Shanti, Shanti. Thank you, everyone. Kriyabans, please stay back and I will see the others.